Thanks. Do I speak loud enough? Yeah. So first I'd like to thank the organizers for giving me the great opportunity to talk here. And also Mario's group and for all this nice organization. So I've changed a bit the title of my talk. So my collections are called Dorfman Collections after all. So I speak about the problem of finding the infinitesimal description of Dirac groupoids. So this is something that I'm going to explain. I start by defining the Dirac groupoids and explaining what I mean by finding this infinitesimal data. Then I'll talk about something that I define doing this, and which I call Dorfman connections. And I show how they a class of Dorfman connections correspond to splittings of the Courant algebraic over a vector bundle. And then I go back to the problem and show you how the infinitesimal objects associated to Dirac groupoids are in fact Malling pairs. So we start with the definition of a Dirac groupoid. Maybe I put this first, I forgot. So this work grew out of a joint work with Thiago Drumont and Christian Ortiz. So I learned a lot from this collaboration. So the definition, a Dirac groupoid is just a Lie groupoid, G over M, with a Dirac structure. So a Dirac structure on the Lie groupoid. A subbundle of Tg plus Lie star G, I'm going to define this again in a minute, such that the Dirac structure itself is a subgroupoid of a bigger groupoid associated to the Lie groupoid. I'm going to explain that. So the set of units of the Dirac structure is the intersection of the Dirac structure with the units of this bigger groupoid, and I will always write A over M for the Lie algebraoid of my Lie groupoid, right? So put this on top. So I start by recalling some backgrounds. If you don't know what Dirac structures are and this big groupoid I'm talking about, so first. What is a Dirac structure? So we have seen a few times that if we have a manifold, here our manifold is a groupoid G, the set of arrows, then we can consider the vector bundle Tg plus T star G over G with the projection on Tg as anchor, a bracket on the sections of Tg plus T star G, so pairs of vector field and one forms given by x alpha with y beta is the Lie bracket of x and y, and Lx beta minus iy d alpha. I call this one the Courant Dorfman bracket. I don't know. And the pairing given by, this is alpha y plus beta x. This whole data is the prototype of something that is called a Courant algebraic, in fact, an exact Courant algebraic. I'm not going to define this in more detail. So. And now what is a Dirac structure? It's just a subbundle of this big vector bundle that is closed under this bracket and self-orthogonal relative to this pairing. We are going to see that there are three standard examples of Dirac structures that you know very well. Then the second thing that I want to explain is that this Courant algebraic is at the same time, well, given a Lie groupoid, so GM is a Lie groupoid, then this big vector bundle, TG plus T sub G, has a natural Lie groupoid structure over TM, so the direct sum of vector bundles, TM plus A star, which is the vector bundle over M. And the Lie algebraic of this big Lie groupoid.
When you say direct sum, you mean the vector bundle direct sum over T?
Over M. It's a vector bundle over M.
But on the left-hand side, is that...
This is a vector bundle over T. Right? So, in fact, you have the canonical projections build a morphism of groupoids. And the Lie algebraic of A of TG plus T star G, A TG plus T star G, is isomorphic via canonical isomorphism to the vector bundle TA plus T star A with a vector bundle structure over TM plus A star. So we have this Lie algebraic, which is also natural, but now we know that we also have a Courant algebraic structure over the manifold A, the vector bundle A seen as a manifold. And we can close this square, so this is a vector bundle over M, this is a vector bundle over M, and what we get is a double vector bundle. So we have two vector bundles over vector bundles that are compatible in a sense. And in addition, we have, as I said, on this side a Lie algebraic structure and on this side a Courant algebraic structure that are in a sense compatible. So now, if we go back to our definition, so we have our Dirac structure, which is a subalgebraic of TG plus T star G seen as a Courant algebraic, and a subgroupoid of TG plus T star G seen as a groupoid. So if we take its Lie algebraic, it's going to be a Lie algebraic over the units, which is a subset of this vector bundle, a subbundle in fact. And via this canonical isomorphism, what we get is in fact a Dirac structure over A and still a Lie algebraic over U. So we can close this square and we get a double subvector bundle of this big vector bundle. The fact that this is a Dirac structure is a result due to my collaborator Christian Ortiz. He has shown that a few years ago in his thesis. So we have our double subvector bundle of this big thing, and it turns out that now that this is a Dirac structure in this Courant algebraic, it becomes a Lie algebraic. So we have a Lie algebraic on this side and a Lie algebraic on this side, and they are in a sense compatible. And we also have a vertical space, so think about it as the double kernel of these two projections. It becomes a vector bundle over M, which I call K. And in fact, it's a sub-vector bundle of A plus T star M, which is the vertical space of this big double vector bundle. And now the question is, well, we know already a lot about this DA. We know that it's a double Lie algebraic, right? But the question is, well, what can we say more? So maybe you don't understand why I asked this question. So I'm going to show you a few examples. So the first example of a Dirac structure on a manifold is a closed two form. So now we look at our group rule, and we take a closed two form on the group rule. So the graph of the vector bundle morphism from TG to C star G, which is associated to this closed two form, just the inner product with the two form, is a Dirac structure. Wait, close. And now Enrique defined in his lecture what it means for a closed two form to be multiplicative, and he said that one of the definitions is that, this vector bundle morphism has to be at the same time a Lie groupoid morphism over some map that I call here lambda. And now, if this is a graph of a Lie groupoid morphism, of course it's going to be a subgroupoid of the direct sum. So this is easy to check. And now, what is our A in this case? So A of d omega g is in fact, the graph in the same sense of the closed two form sigma star, so the pullback of the canonical form on T star M, where sigma is minus the dual of this map, so map going from A to T star M. And omega canonical is a canonical symplectic form on T star M. So here we get immediately that our the algebraoid is at the same time a Dirac structure, and in fact it's a 1-1 correspondence. This is a theorem of Boustin, so Enrique, Alejandro and Christian, which is a generalization of an older theorem of Enrique, Marius, Kreinig, Alan Weinstein, and Chen Chang Zhu. I will write the name again in a minute. What is the theorem? Presymplectic groupoids in a sense. I think that Enrique defined the presymplectic groupoid in a slight stronger way, but this is what I call a presymplectic groupoid. That are source 1 connected, are in 1-1 correspondence to integrable Lie algebraoids with this map that is called an IM2 form. So an IM2 form is a map from the Lie algebraoid to T star M that satisfies two conditions, but that we will not need. Right. So now the second example of a Dirac structure. I don't need that one. So the second example is in the same manner. If you have a Poisson groupoid, so a Lie groupoid endowed with a Poisson bivector that is at the same time, in a sense, multiplicative. Then you can take the graph of the vector bundle homomorphism from T star G to T G associated to it. And it turns out that the Lie algebraoid of this thing that becomes a Dirac groupoid is the graph of the vector bundle homomorphism associated to a Poisson bivector on the Lie algebraoid, which is in addition linear. So what does it mean to have a linear Poisson bivector on a vector bundle? It means that we have a Lie algebraic structure on the dual. And the fact that this, well, Dirac structure is in the same at the same time a Lie algebraic over something, some sub-bundle in here, is encoded in the fact that, well, the pair of Lie algebraics in duality satisfy a condition that makes them being a Lie bi-algebraic. But I'm not going to give it. And again, we have a 1-1 correspondence between Poisson groupoids and Lie bi-algebraics. And this 1-1 correspondence is due to Kirill Mackenzie and Ping Shu. They have shown this in 2000. Right? And now I give you a last example. The last example is, in a sense, the easiest one. What is the most easy example of a Dirac structure on a manifold? It's just the direct sum of an involutive subbundle and its annihilator. So now if you take this subbundle of Tg for Lie groupoid G to be, as I said, involutive and a subgroupoid of the tangent prolongation Tg plus over Tm over a subbundle, then again the direct sum is what is called a multiplicative Dirac structure, and its Lie algebraic is, well, a trivial Dirac structure on A. So here I don't explain how this comes, but I'm going to explain you what is exactly the data that you can find if you start from the groupoid. Maybe I'll do it here. We consider, as I said, a Lie groupoid with a multiplicative involutive subbundle of Tg. And, well, we look at the Bott connection associated to this subbundle. What is the Bott connection? The map, so the partial Fg connection on Tg mod Ft that measures how vector fields in Tg don't preserve the distribution. So how is it defined? Nabla Fg of a vector field in Fg and the class of a vector field on G is just the class of the Lie bracket. But now it turns out that if Fg was multiplicative, so a subgroupoid at the same time, well, we can describe this connection by something in a sense much, much smaller. So this is a theorem of myself and Christian Ortiz. So we have shown that there exists a connection partial connection on the set of units acting on mod the intersection of FG with the V algebra. That encodes a lot of information about the dot connection of the big foliation, in the sense that if you take the dot connection on a section of FG that is T-related, T is the target of our groupoid, to a section of FM, and the class of a right invariant vector field on the groupoid, on the groupoid, then this is nothing else than our smaller connection, the right invariant image of our smaller connection. So just keep in mind that this bit dot connection associated to multiplicative foliation on a groupoid is described by something much smaller in terms of FM, so the units, which is a subbundle of TM, and again, a subbundle of a vector bundle over M. And Eli Hawkins and also Christian and me, independently, have shown that, well, this is all you need to reconstruct the whole this whole vector bundle. So maybe I write again, well, 1-1 correspondence. But now, back to the question, what can we say about DA? Now I can explain you why I asked this question. Well, if you look at the examples, in the first case, this bigger Dirac structure is completely encoded in something, so the Lie algebra A, of course, and a map from A plus T star M. So we have the whole information about DA just by looking at this three thing, because this is, well, this is the graph of the IM2 form in this case. In the second example, just the same, you have this big Dirac structure, D pi A on A, but you don't need to know it, you just need to know some data in terms of A and A star. So again, just need to know A and this thing, which is in that case the graph of the anchor of the algebraic structure on A star. And in the last case, also, we just need to know, well, the units, FM, and this intersection, so only vector bundles over M, and this this connection that has some properties and that we call an IM foliation. In fact, it's what should be called, the whole data that we get here is what should be called the ideal of a Lie algebraic, because it's exactly what you need to take the quotient of a Lie algebraic, but I'm not going to talk about that. So, as a summary, we have all these correspondences. We have the Poisson groupoids corresponding to Lie bi algebraics. So this is due to Mackenzie and Shu. In a group case, it's older. It's due to Drinfeld in the early 80s. Then we have the foliated groupoids corresponding to, well, in a group case, just ideals. And in a groupoid case, this kind of ideal systems. We have the presymplectic groupoids corresponding to IM2 forms. And we know also that the Dirac Lie groups correspond to something, some combination of an ideal in the Lie algebra of the group and the bi algebra structure on the quotient of the Lie algebra by this ideal. So the question is, what corresponds to Dirac groupoids as a generalization of all these things at the same time, which look all, in a sense, very different, right? So, well, the first thing that, well, when one doesn't know what to do, one can be a bit naive and hope that something nice is going to come out. So,
by the way, what does IM stand for?
Infinitesimal multiplicative. Yeah. So let's just be naive and try to do just the same thing, but now with a Dirac structure, a multiplicative Dirac structure on a groupoid, and we replace Tg plus T star Tg by the Courant algebraic Tg plus T star G. So we define a map which I call delta, because it's not quite a connection, as you're going to see, but close to. So it takes sections of Dg and sections of Tg plus T star G mod Dg. So in fact, this is just a dual of Dg, because Dg is a Dirac structure. And we do exactly the same construction, but using not the B bracket of vector fields, but the Courant-Dorfman bracket. Right? So we send a section of Dg, let's call it D, and a section of Tg plus T star G mod Dg, so the class of a section of Tg plus T star G. Well, we send it to the class of the Courant-Dorfman bracket. So then, well, one has to stop being naive and notice, well, this is not a connection. This would be too nice. And then one is a bit desperate, but there's a nice theorem. Well, maybe it's a lemma, because it's a technicality that you use each time you try to prove something about Dirac groupoids, that says that, well, there exists another map defines on sections of U, so the units of this thing, and sections of A plus T star M modeled by this vertical space K. Such that, just like here, well, if you take this big thing, this big map of a D now that is related by the big target map of the big groupoid Pg plus T star G to a section of U, and the right invariant pair of Tg plus T star G, well, you can check that right invariant pairs of vectors and covectors correspond to right invariant images of sections of A plus T star M. So this is easy to check. Well, then, this map for these two kinds of sections is just given by the smaller map. So, well, fine, but we still don't know what these things are. But I claim that, well, the whole information about the Dirac groupoid is encoded in, well, this map, U, and the Lie algebraic. And that's what I'm going to try to explain to you. But first, well, I will have to define what is this strange object that I get, right? So, maybe here. Now, if you're already lost, this part is going to be a bit independent, in fact. So I'm going to define what is a Dorfman connection. So first, I work with something that I decided last week to call just a dull algebraic, because I don't want to say quasi or Leibniz or anything. It's just something very dull. So we take a vector bundle with an anchor. So vector bundle morphism to Tm and a bracket that, well, could be a Lie algebraoid, but don't satisfy skew symmetry, and also not Jacobi. And you should really think of this object this way. It's a Lie algebraoid. So you have the fact that the anchor is a morphism of brackets, and you have the two Leibniz identities, but you don't have skew symmetry of the bracket, and you don't have Jacobi. And in fact, we're going to see that they are not that dull after all, but we'll see. Then, if you have a dull algebraoid, we're going to say that a vector bundle over M is paired with Q. Well, if we have a pairing, on Q times B, which can be zero, so it can be degenerate, but it's a pairing, and a map taking sections of M, functions on M, and sending them to sections of B, such that, well, the pairing of a section Q of Q with DB of a function is the anchor on Q of Q on the function. Right, so here you can think, well, if we started with an actual Lie algebraoid, we can take B the dual, then we have the canonical pairing of the dual and well, A and its dual, and D is just rho star of the derivative of functions, which is in fact this dA, this differential on sections on of A star, right? And now, what is a Dorfman connection? Maybe I'm going to take a new bond. Well, a Dorfman connection is defined like a connection, but it's not quite a connection. So, the Dorfman connection is a map, so a kind of action of Q on B. So, it's R bilinear. That, well, look like a connection in the second argument. So if you take delta of Q and a function F times B, you're going to have F times delta Q of B plus the anchor of Q on F times B. But in the first argument, it's not a connection. But the connection is, the failure to be a connection is measured by the pairing of B and Q as follows. So delta of F times Q of B is again F times delta Q of B plus the pairing of Q and B times DB of F. And the Dorfman connection, satisfies a third condition, which is a kind of Leibniz condition. So if you say, take rho Q and apply it to the pairing of a section Q prime of Q and B of B, then you have like a Leibniz condition. It's the same as taking the bracket, the dull bracket of Q and Q prime with B, plus the pairing of Q prime with this strange action of Q Q1B. Right, so here, well, maybe I'm going to say that in a minute. So what are examples of Dorfman connections? I'm going to show you examples and you're going to say, Dorfman connections are dull. Maybe here.
A dull algebra is quite a general structure. It's basically just a vector bundle with
an anchor,
linear differential thing.
Yeah, well, yeah. That is compatible with the anchor. Well, so examples. Maybe I start here because this one is really not interesting. So you take P, just a vector bundle over M. You take just a trivial pairing between Q and B, and you take dB equals to zero. Then, well, a connection of Q1B, well, an ordinary connection, is going to be a Dorfman connection. This you can see right away, but I don't know if this is really an interesting example. What is a bit more interesting is the second example. So if you have a, well, let's say a Lie algebra. Then you can look at the Lie derivative of sections of its dual along sections of EA. That's just generalizing the Lie derivative of one forms by vector fields if A is the tangent of M. How is it defined? It's defined by, well, the pairing of LA of a section Xi with a section A prime is the same as rho of A on Xi A minus Xi with A prime. So this is in fact defined by the third property. So by the third property, you see that, well, by definition, it's going to satisfy the third property of a Dorfman connection. And you can check easily the two other properties with D, well, dA star equals to rho star D, the derivative of functions, and this pairing, just the canonical pairing, as I said before. So in a sense, now if we look at this condition, now for Q and B, the dual of Q, and we remember how the dual of a connection is defined, then we find that, well, in the case where we are really working with a vector bundle and its dual, the Dorfman connection is nothing else than the dual object to the dull bracket. And this is going to be important. Well, and what is the third important example? Let me write it here. If you take a Courant algebra, and an isotropic subalgebra, well, then you do this construction. You define dk on sections of k times sections of e mod k. Just by saying that dk of a section k with the class of a section e is the Courant-Dorfman bracket of k and e. then you get a Doffman connection. And if K is not only an isotropic subalgebraoid but a Dirac structure, what you get is exactly this object, the delta DG, which is in fact nothing else than the Lie derivative of sections of DG dual along sections of DG. So, since these are the, well, natural examples, I agree that you can say, well, why is it useful? And, like this one. Well, why should it be useful? It's because there's a third class of examples that are, in a sense, very interesting. So you take Q equals E plus T star M. Sorry, this is the wrong one. T M plus E star, where E is a vector bundle over M. You endow it with the anchor, just the projection on TM. And you look at, well, you hope to find Doffman connections of TM plus, so kind of representations of TM plus E star on its dual. Well, first, do we find maps, so Doffman connections, on this kind of objects? Well, yes, for instance, if you take a connection on E, so an ordinary connection, then you can define a map Doffman connection by saying that delta x psi over section E theta is nabla x E and L x theta plus the one form defined like this. Well, this looks strange, but I'm going to explain you in a minute what is the signification of this example. It turns out that this class of Doffman connections correspond to splittings of TE plus T star E over E. So what do I mean by this? It's a theorem so given the vector bundle E over M, then there's a 1-1 correspondence between splittings of TE plus T star E as a vector bundle over E as direct sum of this Dirac structure, so V plus V0, where V is the space that is tangent to the fibers of the vector bundle, plus a horizontal space. Let me write over E. This is in 1-1 correspondence with dull algebraic TM plus E star with PR TM and bracket, dark bracket. Which are, as I said, in 1-1 correspondence with Dorfman connections like that. So Tm plus E star Dorfman connection on E plus T star M. So why is this result nice? It's because, well, I guess that you know that there are two definitions of a connection on a vector bundle. First, the linear connection. So a map of this kind with three properties. Just forget two properties, you forget about this one. And, well, the second definition of a connection of on a vector bundle is just a splitting of TE as this vertical space with a horizontal space. And it turns out that the analogy doesn't stop here. Well, maybe let me write that there. Well, before I talk about this analogy, this example, you can compute it, just corresponds to the splitting TE plus T star E is V plus V0 plus H nabla plus H nabla 0. So a splitting of this Dirac structure and an almost Dirac structure in general. And the analogy doesn't stop here. We know that the curvature of an ordinary connection measures the failure of this horizontal space to be involutive. And for a Dorfman connection, we have the same. So the failure of the dark bracket to be anti-symmetric measures the failure of our horizontal space in TE plus T star E to be isotropic, so Lagrangian. And the failure of the curvature, because you can define the curvature of a Dorfman connection, measures the failure of the horizontal space to be closed under the Courant Dorfman bracket. And the Dorfman connection itself measures the Courant Dorfman bracket of nice horizontal and vertical sections, in fact. So we have a complete analogy of the Courant, for the Courant Dorfman algebraic structure on TE plus T star E. So now we can go back to our problem. Remember that so now our vector bundle E is going to be a Lie algebraic A. We're going to be in this case. And we know now that splittings of A plus T star A correspond to Dorfman connections on A, so on Tm plus A star Dorfman connections on A plus T star M. And we can completely describe this side, the geometry of this side, by choosing the right splitting. In particular, now our Dirac structure is a double subvector bundle, so we will always find a splitting such that this dA is nothing else than dA intersect with this vertical space plus dA intersect with L. Then we have we can look at the horizontal sections of dA, the vertical sections of dA, the other way, and we can completely determine using the Dorfman connection and the dull algebraoid when dA is going to be a Dirac structure over A. So let's say L is, in this sense, adapted to dA, then dA is a Dirac structure over A, if and only if, well, first it has to be isotropic, so you look at the conditions, you get that this U has to be the annihilator of K. U lives in Tm plus A star and K in A plus T star M, which are dual to each other. Then the Dorfman connection applied to sections of U and sections of K has to be a section of K. And now if you look at the restriction of this map, since U and K annihilate each other, you get a real connection. And U, with a projection on Tm, and the restriction of the dull bracket that is equivalent to our splitting, is a Lie algebraoid. Well, so now we know exactly how to characterize this side, this side, in terms of this three object and the Dorfman connection. And for the other side, once you have understood the splitting, and you know the work of Rajan and Alfonso about representations up to homotopy and the structure of VB algebraoid, because if you just look at this side, it's a VB algebraoid, then you're going to find nice connections. They are not difficult, they just look like the basic connections, if you know what the basic connections are. Now, of A, on A plus T star M, well, maybe I should write it somewhere else, but okay. And another connection of A on Tm plus A star that are, as I said, naturally associated to the splitting. And a curvature term that describe completely the other side. But I don't want to write down the formulas because they are quite technical and it will not really help you, but I find how to express this Lie algebraic structure. So in fact, this Lie algebraic structure, sorry. Yeah, I wrote it the wrong way, but anyway. In terms of the splitting. It's two connections, but they are just both called the same. Maybe I will.
Are they equivalent?
No, they are not even dual to each other. Right. So now you can do the same as in this theorem. You look at your sub-double vector bundle, you look at these connections, you get a bunch of conditions. They don't really help you because you think that they are connection dependent. No, they are not, in fact. But what you get, summing up all these conditions, I do have 5 minutes. Well, maybe I will tell you what the first condition what is the first condition that you get for this to be a subalgebra in? You get that the map rho star, rho is the anchor of A. It goes from A plus T star M to T M plus A star. And this map restricts to a map from K to U. And this means that if you look, now this is a strange construction, but I'm going to advertise it. If you look at the vector bundle U plus A plus T star M, mod out by the graph of minus this map that you get, then this thing is a vector bundle over M, and it inherits a natural connection independent courant algebraic structure such that U, which we have seen is a Lie algebra, is a Dirac structure, is a Dirac structure in here. So I'm going to write down the bracket maybe. And well, the bracket, if I take sections of this big thing, so the classes of sections of these big things, I'm going to write them U plus sigma, with U in U and sigma in A plus T star M. The bracket looks like a net pair of two things that are not connections. So it's a bit, it's a long formula, of course. So, but I just write it down so that you have it, but don't be afraid if you don't understand it. Let's call this one Nablabas, basic. Well, it looks like a match pair of something, but when this bracket is the Courant-Dorfman-like bracket that you get on sections of E plus T star M, it looks like a match pair of something, and all the conditions that you get just help you to check that it's a Lie algebra. So the answer to the question is that the infinitesimal data associated to a Dirac groupoid is, well, the triple A, B, and U, with A an integrable Lie algebra, and B and U, a Manin pair, as in the work of Enrique Pavol, Chevera, and David. This B looks strange, but it's very natural in a sense, because it's exactly, well, in the case of a Poisson groupoid, now I don't have time to write down how you do it, but the construction is very easy, how you recover the Dirac structure associated to the Dirac structure associated to a Poisson structure on a Lie groupoid. It's very easy. And the courant algebra that you get is A plus T plus A star. where A star is a Libye algebra, right? And we know by a work of Ping Shu, Alan Weinstein, and you, that the homogeneous Poisson, the Poisson homogeneous spaces are classified in the sense in via Dirac structures in A plus A star. Here we have the same. The Dirac homogeneous spaces of a Dirac groupoid are classified by a Dirac structure in here. And it's also natural in a sense because I think that David Liebland studied reduction of Courant algebraic by Dirac structure, and he found out that this Courant algebraic is just a reduction of Tg plus T star G by the Dirac structure. So, but this is something that we have to discuss. Right. Yeah, that's all. I wanted to show you examples. They are in fact very easy. How the IM2 forms and the Libye algebraic works, but I don't have time.